to infinity and beyond!
This is me. This is how I win.
Were you rushing or were you dragging? Answer!
You're a wizard, Harry.
Say what again? Say what again? I dare you!
No. I am your father.
Hasta la vista, baby.
Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained?
And here we go.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back inside the film room. Zach Goins here with Jake Lawler.
Hello.
We have a full episode today. Ton of news to talk about. Double streaming review with The Old Guard and Palm Springs. And we have a very special guest. You know him from his greatest hits, like Denis Villeneuve, director of the decade, interviews with Joe Lettieri and Donald Mowat. It's Johnny Sobczak, inside the film room senior writer. Welcome, Johnny.
I am back, ladies and gentlemen. I look a little different this time for anyone who hasn't seen me before, but yeah, I'm excited to be back. I've only been on once, and that was probably a couple months ago now. So I've definitely gotten
together
more
in quarantine.
Yeah, yeah. But I've got more into the groove, and it's been an exciting week recently with inside the film room. Some of the stuff I've been working on. So it's a fitting time for me to make my return, I think.
Yeah, I mean, you've been blowing up. Let's see. Give the people, the listeners who may not have been following as closely on social or on the website, what is the big week that you had for inside the film room?
Yeah, so it was actually a week ago today, last Sunday, I got in contact with Donald Mowat. For anyone who doesn't know, he's a really accomplished and acclaimed makeup designer in the film industry. He's worked on a lot of Denis Villeneuve's films, Blade Runner 2049, and he's working on the upcoming Dune, of course. So we got in contact, one thing led to another, and I did an interview last week, and we published it, you know, I think it was Tuesday or Wednesday. And it, you know, people have been supporting it. The reaction's been great. The response has been great from the readers and
that Dune
people been watching it on YouTube. Yeah, so it's just been a really fun and kind of rewarding few days, and to see everyone respond to it so well and to have one of the best interviews I've ever had, honestly. It was just with someone who's so high profile and someone I respect a lot. It's been really great, and I'm excited. And I have to thank you, obviously, for the opportunity, because without Inside the Film Room, I wouldn't have any clout or pull.
No street cred to be like, hey, just Donald, I'm a big fan, you want to just talk and we can just tweet it out.
I'll put it on Twitter.
No, it's an equal partnership there, because anytime that Johnny posts anything Dune related for Inside the Film Room, it's like, you know, we're just plateauing at our normal numbers, and then suddenly you look at the chart and it's like 10 times the amount of clicks or views than it must be a Dune post.
Hey, we got
getting those, shout getting out those to subreddits, the fans. Getting those subreddits, and it's lights out. So, yeah, definitely check that out. We've got the written piece on the website. We've got the full video interview, and the written piece is just mainly the highlights, the Dune related stuff and Villeneuve stuff. But full interview, very exciting stuff on YouTube if you want to check that out, and then some bits and pieces on social as well. But Johnny isn't the only one that had a big week this week. Let's get into some real estate talk here, Jake Lawler.
So I was looking for a place to live in Los Angeles, and fortunately I found one. A friend of mine was able to connect me with a friend of his, and I met one of the tenants. So I'll be moving out, driving out the 28th, driving across the country, and then moving in early August to, I'm actually living in Hollywood, which is hilarious.
Man. Living the dream.
East Hollywood, so.
I did look up the address. I was like, okay, wow, you were right in between like Burbank and LA. I was like looking at the map. It's like blocks away from the Chinese theater. Like,
yeah, it's
like
so
right in the thick of things.
Yeah, I know. So it's centralized. Everybody that I met with is around that. Subtract maybe a few people. So it's going to be really good to just be close by. And so, like, you know, just to get things rolling. But yeah, I'm really excited about it.
So with that trip, is it going to be, are you just like booking it to get out there? Or is it going to be kind of like a fun little, I know you can't really do much in like COVID, but at least maybe see some sights along the way.
Yeah, we'll probably stretch it out over 5-6 days, something like that. But yeah, I mean, the plan right now is, and I bought all of the furniture of the former tenant, that lived in my space, so all I have to bring out is clothes, which is nice. So
who's accompanying you?
My dad.
No, Connor.
It's like Logan. Yeah.
He's escorting you to safety. Exactly.
Yeah, so that's gonna be good though. We're excited for it.
And what happens when you get there? Are you hitting the ground running, or is it kind of
there's a few things that I have kind of lined up right now just to get things going slowly. I'm talking to a producer out there that's been helping with a few things, and this week I'm gonna like re-hit everybody up that I met with and kind of keep in constant contact with and be like, hey, this is when I'm moving out, let's schedule a time, blah blah blah, and go from there. So yeah, the plan right now is to just re-meet basically everyone, reevaluate where I can fit in, and then start working.
I'm sure Johnny can put you in touch with someone if you'd like to get into the makeup business.
Yeah. Yeah, he knows one guy. Yeah. He knows one guy. a great guy to know, though. Great guy to know in the business, I'm telling you. But, and then hopefully our short film will be done around the same time that I'm moving in, so I can
throw
that off as well. So,
yeah, moving quickly on that one.
Yeah, we're doing what we can.
That's exciting. We're gonna miss you over here.
Yeah.
I'm gonna leave the Southeast regional correspondence for ITFO.
Yeah, inside the film room gets their first West Coast correspondent. So we'll be good to go.
Coast to coast now, I'm telling you.
We move.
Yeah. And Zach, what's rumbling with you?
You got nothing
coming up.
Yeah, one big thing, nothing big this week to really escalate like you guys have, but I'm 2 weeks away from the puppy.
Let's go.
So that puppy will be filling your role on Inside the Film Room. But
he's gonna be much more eloquent than I am, I'll tell you that.
Oh, I'm gonna teach him so many big words so he can sound just like you. No, very excited. Golden retriever puppy. We've already planned. Your family just got one a couple months ago, maybe a month or two. So Indy and my pup Remy are going to be best friends. We've already scheduled play dates, so I'm excited for that. Exactly. And he's named after Remy from Ratatouille, the greatest Pixar movie.
Wow.
A good Pixar movie, I gotta agree.
It is great.
Yeah, so that's the intro talk here before we get down into the movie world, but lots of stuff happening for everybody over here. But
very, very proud of everyone.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know, proud of me for getting a dog. I'm an adult.
Do what you can.
So let's get into some movie news, fellas. First up, classic, every episode, there's some sort of coronavirus related delay. So big news out of the Universal horror world. Lots of pushback dates here. Candyman, which was supposed to come out September 25th of this year, has moved a couple weeks back to October 16th, 2020, which now takes the place of Halloween Kills, the second in the new Halloween trilogy, which is moving from October 2020 to October 2021. And of course, that means that the third movie, which was October 2021, has now moved to October 2022. And then also somewhere thrown in the middle is Forever Purge, which was supposed to come out 2 days ago, is now next summer, July 2021. But yeah, for me personally, I think the biggest news there is that Halloween, and not necessarily the biggest, because I'm excited for Candyman too, but the most substance that we got from anything was the Halloween announcement. Because first of all, I think they're in a sucky position, because unlike Candyman, who can push back a couple weeks, like, you're Halloween, you can't just like push Halloween to come out in January,
February.
Right, exactly. You've got to push that a whole year, and then when you got another one in the same position, that means that's affected as well. So, but with that, I mean, we got the first tease for that. I know, Johnny, you've seen the original, of course, but not the 2018, the reboot to get this trilogy started. Jake and I both pretty big fans of that one. but we got the first tease of what Halloween Kills will have in store from John Carpenter, and it seems to be picking up immediately after the end of the first one. Jake, what was your reaction to that?
Yeah, John Carpenter's always, we've talked about it numerous times, but John Carpenter's one of my favorite directors. I mean, so much of his stuff is really sort of iconic in the horror space and really in the cinema space. And when you make a faithful adaptation, when you do it the right way, I think similar to one of Johnny's favorite movies, Blade Runner 2049, it's faithful enough to the world that it's in, but does enough different things to make it feel original. And I think that that's what the new one did. I know that we enjoyed it a lot. It added a lot more humor than the original Halloween, but it did some really smart things. And I think with that momentum, because it made a lot of money, it was super successful. With that momentum, we can only hope that these next two will be as good and as entertaining.
I want to ask you about the tease that we got. So basically, as anyone who saw the 2018 version knows, the movie ends where Laurie has seemingly trapped Michael Myers in the basement of her booby-trapped mansion, Home Alone style, and it's on fire, burning down, and they it seems like they've escaped. But of course, we know this is a trilogy, so I don't think they're escaping.
And it's Michael Myers, so.
Exactly. So he has died quite a few times before and then come back. So, but what we see in this tease is that, okay, they're in the back of the truck as they leave. They're finally running away from this monster forever. And then the fire, we see fire engines going the opposite way, going to put out the fire. And Laurie's just like, no, no, no. So what do you, like, do you, I liked it. I thought that was great. Wow, they're really picking up. Like, it's immediately, it's kind of like the John Wick movies, like just following immediately. Yeah,
just like, or the second one.
But with that being known that, like, obviously this is a trilogy, do you think that they need to explicitly state, like, oh, no, this is how he escaped? Or do you wish it had been somewhat of just like a, okay, mystery, he pops back up in Halloween Kills? Like, we don't need to know that, okay, someone put out the fire, so that's how he survived, you know? Because it's like Michael Myers, the mystique behind him is that somehow he always survives without needing to know how.
No, I mean, I thought, just like you, I mean, I thought it was a great teaser. I think that there's something so powerful about when you're using images, especially with the fire trucks. And it's like the fire trucks are always kind of known as something for safety and security and rescue. And the fact that they're screaming for them to stop is just something that's really cool and something that's very Carpenter-esque. So yeah, I think it was really cool.
I'm with you.
Also, quick shout out to Candyman. I watched the original a few months ago. And it was awesome. I loved it. I don't know if it's on Netflix anymore, but like we said, I'm really excited for this one. I think it's going to be really good.
Yep. Excited for that as well.
Yeah, I think just to chime in real quick, Candyman, I think, is going to benefit the most out of all these. Because, of course, as we said, it only moved several weeks, which is not a big deal as far as marketing and kind of keeping the hype going. But now it's close. It's into October. It's closer to Halloween.
Yeah.
If theaters are open and people are feeling more comfortable in a few months to go back to theaters, I think they're going to be in a spot where they can make a good profit and do well. So
even, obviously, we all are huge proponents of the theatrical experience, but like even without, like, I feel like this could be one that could also be successful if it were to go to video on demand. Because with like every October, it's like, okay, I'm gonna throw on this old Halloween. Like, we're getting together, we're like snuggled up under me and Bay, snuggled up under a blanket. We're watching a scary movie, and especially if it is like the current state where people aren't going out, dressing up, going trick-or-treating, doing like going to parties or anything like that. Like, even more so, I'm looking to have a bonfire and watch a scary movie or something like that. And if it's something new that I can explore, then I'd be all for that. So I think, obviously, I'd like to see it in a theater, but if that's not the case, I don't think it's the end of the world.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And even the nature of the Candyman world, I mean, the themes are so resonant with gentrification and race that you could really release it anytime and it can still be in this
social
climate. And plus, Yahya Abdul-Mateen is just a national treasure at this point. So I'm really excited to see what he does with this.
If he's not careful, Nicolas Cage might come after him.
Oh, that'd be sweet.
Yeah, make that into a movie.
Remake Face Off.
So Speaking of, see, Jake, I wrote a lot. This was natural in my progression here on our little on our Google Doc. I was able to work in a lot of your segues already. So it's more not off the dome, but it works. So speaking of Universal and horror movies, Leigh Whannell from our beloved Invisible Man, not so much Johnny, but beloved for Jake and I, he is now in talks to direct Ryan Gosling's Wolfman. We talked about that movie a couple weeks ago. What's the take here? I know, Johnny, have you seen Upgrade? I know we've talked about that.
I have seen Upgrade. I liked Upgrade definitely more than The Invisible Man. I enjoyed it more. But I think as someone that didn't enjoy The Invisible Man as much as most other people did, obviously, I am much more excited by this news and this project. I didn't anticipate Whannell to get this because he, like we said, he just did The Invisible Man. But I guess he's in their good graces so much that they trust him to kind of take care of Ryan Gosling and do a film like Wolfman, which is obviously going to be a big part of their new kind of monster verse, if you want to call it that for now.
The rebooted dark universe.
Yeah. Minus Tom Cruise and Johnny Depp and everyone else. But I think from what I've heard so far about this, for someone that didn't enjoy the previous film with Whannell and The Invisible Man, this sounds really interesting, what has been reported about it, where it's going to be sort of a satirical dark comedy. Supposedly, the Wolfman's going to be kind of someone in the news industry, potentially like a broadcast anchor or something like that.
Nightcrawler.
Nightcrawler network to an extent, where it's going to be taking a stab, no pun intended, at kind of what people are willing to do or to be in the news industry and to make news or affect news or how they tell news to people like at large. So I think that could be a really fun and interesting take on it. And of course, Ryan Gosling, I love him. He's one of my favorite actors and we've seen before how good he can be with comedy. So this sounds like it could be really, really good.
Yeah. Whannell is one of my favorite new directors. I loved Upgrade. I remember Zach and I saw it in the theater and we were just enamored with it. I rewatched it with my brother who also kind of fell in love with it. And I think that I also like Upgrade more. I really liked Invisible Man, but I think that really what Johnny was talking about, the nature of this film is more suited to Whannell's strengths, at least the ones that he played in Upgrade. I think a lot of what it sounds like has kind of sort of a similar vein to what he did in Upgrade in terms of the themes that he brought and the satirical nature of everything and sort of the stuff that he was talking about with technology and sort of the vices and the downfalls that come with it. So I think that he is, and he also signed the first look deal with Blumhouse to develop stuff. So I think that if they are giving him the keys to the dark universe, then this would make sense just because of the stuff that has happened on the business side.
Right. That's what I was going to bring up is the fact that with him doing these first two, I mean, obviously there was The Mummy, but then they kind of scrapped it and then rebooted the reboot of the dark universe. But with him having the lead on these first two movies, and then we've got Elizabeth Banks is doing The Invisible Woman. But I mean, we've got Frankenstein up in the air still, like some of those other more traditional horror villains.
And we know Karen Kusama, who did The Invitation, which is a kind of a little more of a smaller like cult horror film that people have been really liked. She is apparently attached to do Dracula. Yeah. Which I think is a perfect pairing. I think that could be really exciting, especially if they get someone awesome to play Dracula. So I think from the projects that they have stirring right now and the people they have attached, they're definitely on the right track from my point of view. But
I'm interested to see. I don't know. The first thought, this doesn't necessarily connect, but the first thought that I have from hearing this is like a DC version, like how the Zack Snyder basically was like handed the keys and then like things went wrong and then DC was like in a pit. So like, I don't know. Warner Brothers obviously connected there as well. I don't know. Or sorry, this is Universal, not Warner Brothers, but like connecting that there, like, I don't know. Hopefully they don't follow the same, like getting too attached with one director and then like having people be upset with how the other things worked out. So I don't think with this being like more of a historical like IP versus something that's so beloved as and passionate like as comic books that that'll really be the case. But I don't know, just something to hopefully prevent.
Agreed.
So, Jake, would you like to take the next piece of news?
Oh yes. Oh yes. Okay.
or maybe you take the next one, because there's a great transition that I wrote there.
Oh, okay. Yeah, let's do that. Let's do that, because I read that article like six times for the next piece.
So. Okay. So I'll lead into this one. So this one, first off, it's strictly speculation, but Vivica A. Fox said in an interview this week with NME that she hopes to see Zendaya cast as her character, Vernita Green's daughter, Nikki, in a potential third installment of Kill Bill. Johnny and I both watched those movies for the first time earlier this year. Jake, I know you've seen them as well, but this is exciting for me, because I was a big fan of both of them. Tarantino has been teasing the potential third volume here since 2004, and he's said that would be the plot. It would be Nikki seeking revenge on the bride. So, I mean, I'm a Zendaya stan, so I'm down with it. I think that would be great. What are your reactions there?
Johnny, you want to take it first?
Yeah, as you pointed out, I just watched these movies not too long ago, and I loved them, of course. As a whole, because I really do consider, I know people get caught up in the semantics and the technicalities. Is it one movie? Is it, you know, two movies? Mm-hmm. Of course, now it's going to be like three movies. So, but it is one big story for me. I do consider it just one piece, because even originally Tarantino wanted to release it as one movie, but Weinstein had to come in and break it up. So I think that this would be a really cool idea for continuation, of course. And Zendaya is such a huge star. It does make sense. At least from a marketing standpoint or from a financial standpoint, you want to attach a big name to it. Zendaya is probably a pretty good choice. And she's kind of getting more and more into acting and is showing off her chops more in stuff like Euphoria. And something else that's coming up that we're going to talk about in a minute. So I think that, you know, I think that would be a really cool idea. And of course, Tarantino is going to do whatever Tarantino wants to do. But I think I would totally be behind it. I'd also totally be behind it if he went a different direction with someone else that's pretty well known, or if he went with someone who's a little bit less known.
But this is, we've always heard it's going to be 10 movies and then he's retiring. So would you be satisfied, asterisk by a lot of that, but if he were to use his quote unquote 10th movie and then step away, is that satisfying, or would you rather see him do something else?
It's twofold for me. I would be totally fine and satisfied if this was his last movie and then he called it a day. Also, I think I would be totally be satisfied and consider it legitimate if he said that it's a third volume, but it's still part of one movie that is Kill Bill. And then he kind of uses that as an excuse and then does like one final film, quote unquote, after Kill Bill or before, whatever he wants to do.
I feel like you can pass volume one and two off as one movie because he made them like back to back pretty much. But then when it's...
Right.
15 yeah. years later, I think that's a different movie.
Yeah, no, that's fair too. So it's gonna be interesting to see from his, you know, he can do anything he wants literally, so it's gonna be interesting to see how he goes about approaching it, if he really does stick to that rule that he's been talking about.
Yeah, and I think just what's with Tarantino, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is my favorite Tarantino movie, and that came out a year ago, and you know, he's had such a storied career that he shows no signs of slowing down.
So why stop now?
Yeah. Zendaya, I just thought Zendaya was like the internet girlfriend for a long time before Euphoria came out. And then I watched it and she is just brilliant, like throughout. I mean, just the ability to be so vulnerable and so powerful and have all these different feelings and emotions displayed on screen in such a way that speaks to everybody, even people that don't necessarily go through the things that her character Ruru goes through. It's supremely exciting that could be a possibility, that could be a potential for something, because I, in addition to being such a marketable star, like Johnny said, she's also supremely talented, and you know, that match made in heaven is really something that is exciting and something to keep your eye on.
It sounds like, based on what I read from the interview with Vivica A. Fox, she wasn't talking about being marketable, being a big star, being a good actress. Her reasoning was, her and Uma Thurman are both tall and badass, so they would look cool fighting each other.
That's true. Yeah, definitely. Oh, and true. It probably helps that, you know, if not in this first movie, potentially the second one with Dune, Zendaya is going to be in that.
Yeah,
she's badass as hell in that movie. She's probably going to get some good fighting experience, and she's just going to get her name out there even more and become a bigger star. So all those things kind of work together as far as big projects that she could have coming up.
And Spider-Man still.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Now, give me some web shooters.
Speaking of Zendaya, something a little bit more concrete. Zendaya, John David Washington, and Euphoria creator Sam Levinson started and finished an entire movie during quarantine. So they are more productive than every one of us and every one of us abroad. So the movie has been rumored to have some parallel story.
You did that.
I did do that. I did, but I did not have Zendaya or John David Washington in my movie. I had Jake Lawler and Connor Lawler in my movies. but the movie is rumored to have some parallels to Marriage Story while incorporating more modern social themes of what's currently going on in America. The crazy thing, and there's a lot of crazy stuff about this news that just really came out of nowhere. I mean, just, it's like they dropped the article and I was like, what the hell is going on?
Yeah.
it's like Blitzkrieg affair. So apparently Euphoria season 2 shut down March 16th. Just because of coronavirus. And a few days after that, Zendaya called Sam Levinson and suggested that they make a movie. And he wrote the script in 6 days, got it cleared, sent it over to John David Washington, got him on board, got a lot of producers on board, including Kid Cudi, which I think is really cool, just because I love his music. But they filmed it from June 17th to July 2nd at the Caterpillar House, an environmentally conscious glass architectural marvel in Carmel, California. And they did all the WGA, DGA, SAG-AFTRA, COVID-19 safety protocols, finished the entire movie, finished shooting it. I'm really excited for it. Zendaya, I think, is brilliant. John David Washington, I think, is brilliant. Sam Levinson did a tremendous job with Euphoria. I didn't see Assassination Nation, so I can't really speak on that. But in terms of his vision, in terms of things, and especially the content of it, I think this is really suited to, this really plays to his strengths. What are you guys thinking?
I'm just going to chime in real quick. A question for you, actually, Jake. What do you think, as I didn't read the article, you obviously have, did they mention it all, or is there any speculation about when this film's going to come out, or
that was
where?
My question,
is it a streaming service, or is it supposed to be, you know, I would, you know, since it's the Euphoria gang kind of working on this, I'd be curious if like HBO maybe is involved or might want to release it.
A24 is like also that. A producer of Euphoria, so maybe there might be some connection there.
Yeah. From what I gathered, they didn't really have anything concrete in terms of distribution yet, but I think this could really go either way. If they get done editing it by the end of the year, I mean, maybe they could do a theatrical release if things are just getting worse, because I think that Zendaya is such a marketable star anyway, that people are just going to watch it regardless. And John David Washington is set to be, is set to go into the stratosphere with Tenet coming out. And it's similar to what we were talking about with Candyman. I think that just the accessibility portion of it may make it more appealing to the audience it may be suited for, just because of Zendaya's group. But I do think that either way they go, I think that it's going to be successful, whether it's theatrical or whether it's distributed via streaming services.
Mm-hmm. I think it would be, I mean, who knows what the status of the world is going to be like by the time this is done put together, but like, it would be cool to be a streaming release considering it was like a quarantine movie. Like to keep that consistent, like okay, we made this quickly in quarantine and we're going to give it to you where it's easily accessible. Hopefully we're not all still in quarantine by then. But
I was going to ask you guys too, it's kind of a question I'm asking myself. It sounds really cool. I mean, I'm totally on board. Like, these two leads are awesome. Euphoria is supposed to be really great. I still need to watch it. They made it so quickly. They wrote it so quickly. They filmed it and under all these, you know, kind of strenuous protocols. I'm going to watch it regardless, but and I hope it's good, but how good do you think this could actually be?
Yeah, no, that's a great question, because that's the same thing I was wondering. I was like, they wrote it in less than a week. They shot it in like 2 weeks. They moved so quickly on it. You want, because the great films take a long time. You know, most films just generally take 2 years to develop and film and get done and be released. So the fact that they did all this in a matter of basically like a month and a half or so it's exciting and it's interesting and it's definitely on brand for everyone involved. Mm-hmm. But on the same sense, I think that there is the sort of concern that they may have rushed into it. Mm-hmm. But I think John David Washington has made really smart career choices up to this point. Zendaya has made really smart career choices up to this point. It would seem strange and almost nonsensical if they just rushed a movie just because they wanted to do it. And if it was anyone else, the alarm bell would be going off. But getting a huge star attached to mm-hmm. a movie like John David Washington to star alongside Zendaya is something that sort of kind of alleviates some of the tension for me.
Mm-hmm. I'm with you. I mean, obviously none of us can speak on the storyline, not having seen a script, read a script or whatever. But for me, there's a sense of comfort in knowing that it doesn't matter what you put in front of John David Washington or Zendaya, knowing both of them and what they're capable of as far as acting goes, like they'll give it 100% and do the best possible work that they can with it. So yeah. I think that it all comes down to the script itself, the story itself. And that's not something that we're really in a position to talk on yet. But I mean, I'm comfortable with knowing how talented they both are and that we're going to get their best.
And I think at the very least, it will be interesting, which is far better than a lot of films. And also, yeah. I think
that there you go.
Levinson's direction in Euphoria is right. just amazing. I mean, he makes some really bold, uncompromising choices with the camera, with the structure, with the color. And we can only hope that with an all glass house, he can do some really
yeah. good.
Right. I was That's about what... to ask, have you guys seen, like, I was on like Google Images looking at all the different photos of, because it's yeah. like made from recycled dirt and like glass everywhere and like no AC because the windows just work so perfect. Like yeah. it was all very interesting to hear that. And I think that can set up for some seeing people's reflections or like seeing from the outside looking at, like, I don't know, just like creative, yeah. really creative choices.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Strong agree. I think it'll be at the very least, it'll be a kind of cool experimental avant-garde sure. type of yeah. film. So,
and also just like the fact that, I mean, obviously with everything that's been going on, people have been trying to amplify Black voices and Black stories and stuff. And then there's also like the argument of, okay, well, it doesn't have to be a movie, a book, a story about slavery, about civil rights, about
yeah,
like these yeah. tragedies, like the horrific things that have happened. But instead, like, if it's like Marriage Story, this is just going to be like a love story with Black leads. So to tell like more normal stories with Black leads, I mean, that's something that everyone is looking forward to seeing more of, and mm-hmm. that there needs to be more of. So I think that's important to note as well.
Yeah.
Strong agree.
Absolutely.
Johnny, I want to get your thoughts on this next one first. Because I know so the news here is that Jude Law is basically a done deal to become Captain Hook in Disney's live action Peter Pan and Wendy film. First of all, general thoughts on that. Well, okay, hold on. I'll go. So Johnny, for those of you who don't know, Johnny is pretty anti Disney live action remakes. And I mean, we've all been pushed to our limits by that, but Johnny yeah. more so than others.
Agreed.
But first off, before we get into that, just general thoughts on this casting here. I mean, I'm not super, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, Jude Law, I haven't, you know, as someone that's as famous as he is and has been around for as long as he has, I haven't seen him in a lot. I know he's an acclaimed actor. He's very accomplished. You know, the Pope show on HBO.
Is it new or is it young?
I think it's young. But anyway, I watched a little bit of that when it first came on. I want to go back and finish it. But, I mean, he's great in that. So, and that's a thing that's ongoing. So he's
Fantastic
still, you know,
Beasts.
Yeah, it's just, I don't know, man. He was in Captain Marvel, which I still haven't seen. And it's just like...
And he was in the Sherlock Holmes movies with Robert Downey
right,
Jr.
Right, yeah. Which are, you know, those are interesting, pretty good. I just don't know. I think no matter who they put in these movies, no matter how talented, I mean, some of these other names, which we're about to talk about, are huge, very talented actors. I can't get excited because I know at the end of the day, the environment and the constraints that these people are working under with regards to the script or the director or the studio, most especially the producers. So, I mean, it is what it is. I'm glad that people enjoy them. And I you know, I wish I liked them more or I could appreciate them more, but this really does nothing for me. Maybe if it was one of these other bigger actors I really love a lot, I would be more into it. And David Lowery, I mean, he's a great director and that's something I think that could make this a little more interesting, but this news doesn't really do anything for me.
The person we're referencing, apparently Joaquin Phoenix was reportedly offered the role and decided against it, turned it down. That's someone that Johnny, as a yeah. huge Joker fan and just Joaquin in general, that's the person he's referencing when he says that might make him excited.
Yeah, well, even and supposedly also Adam Driver was another person that they approached.
That would be interesting.
Again, amazing actor, really big right now. That Adam Driver is so hot right now. Zoolander reference, but I would have preferred either of those guys, I think, from a interest point of view, but I think no matter who they put in here, it's not anything that's gonna get me amped up.
Jake, any initial thoughts on that news?
I've never really had an affiliation with Peter Pan ever.
I feel like for me personally, like, Peter Pan is like a young boy, you're like, think that's so cool, but then like the movie itself, not great. Like, it's not like
also
up there.
Peter Pan's kind of a prick.
Yeah,
let's be real.
I feel like I was Peter Pan 1 year for Halloween as a kid. I was Captain Hook for another year. Like, that was, it's just like, I feel like that's like a classic like little boy movie that you watch like as a kid. Yeah. But then like, it's, the movie itself isn't great. I don't think, like, it's not like up there when you think about like, when I think about like my Disney classics, like the ones that I love from my childhood, it's not really up there. I mean, there's definitely interesting stuff that's been done. I don't know. Like, I, when I was in like elementary and middle school, I was like a huge reader. So I read the Peter and the Star Catcher books. I don't know if you're familiar, but it was like a retelling, a more like adult kind of retelling of that by Dave Barry and Ridley Pearson, I think. But like, those were exciting, and there have been different interpretations of the story. I mean, obviously it's not even a Disney story. It's like a classic J.M. Barry that was then picked up by Disney and told. So, I mean, there's a lot you can do there, but I want to ask, I know, Johnny, you've had enough live actions, and most of us have, but in the, like, we know that they're going to keep being made until they stop selling tickets. In your estimation, what is, like, where does this fall in your rankings of, like, I want to see this one. If they're going to do it, they might as well do this movie. But, I mean, Peter Pan, like, if you can't tell, and not super high on my list.
I would say, you know, Peter Pan itself would not be anywhere close to being high up on my list, especially because it's been done in live action several times at this point. Mm-hmm. As it stands now, I'm more interested in it than I would be in some of the other previous films that have come out or other ones that are in development, simply because David Lowery, I think, is an interesting choice as director, and Jude Law is a good actor. But again, it does not like jump up there for me, even in comparison to other Disney live action movies necessarily.
Because I mean, Jake and I have been on the live action Hercules train for a while, and thank God it's finally coming.
Yeah, that should be pretty cool. Little Mermaid sounds pretty cool as well. That cast is really good. Yeah. The director is gonna, but we'll see.
Any excitement on your front, Jake, or is it something else you'd rather see?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think I agree with both of you. Like, Hercules is at my list. Like, at the, like, if I don't really care if they make it or not, but if they're going to, I would like to see Hercules done first. Little Mermaid, same way, with the choices that they
make. Treasure Planet.
God, that'd be sick.
That's just what I was about to say. Is that like
Atlantis?
Atlantis would be really cool. I mean, I love swashbuckling. I love all that stuff. Peter Pan never did it for me. I watched Treasure Planet religiously when I was a kid. I mean, I must have watched it every week just because I thought that I was Jimbo. They have a really good song by the Goo Goo Dolls singer John Resnick in there. It's like literally just the song that got me amped for fifth grade. but I love Treasure Planet. It would be an enormous budget to make it right. Mm-hmm.
Gave Mulan $300 million. So
yeah,
it's Disney. Money to burn.
Yeah. So if they do Treasure Planet, then that would be fantastic. And I agree with Johnny. I think David Lowery's a really interesting choice to go in. I still want to see The Green Knight.
Hell yeah.
I was really excited for that. It was a shame that coronavirus messed it up, as it did most of the film world. But hopefully whenever that comes out, it will live up to my expectations, because I was really excited for that. So yeah, I mean, you know, there's some, but you know, I think that in terms of a broad scale, there are things that I would rather look into.
Final question here on Peter Pan before I move on. What direction would you, I mean, you're talking about David Lowery as an interesting director. What kind of angle would you like to see taken at this story? Because like Johnny mentioned, we've seen it so many times. Like just even most recently, we've seen Hook with Robin Williams and Dustin Hoffman back in the 90s. We saw the live action Peter Pan in 2003. We saw Pan in 2015, where Hugh Jackman was Blackbeard, not Captain Hook. And then there was Wendy, which was like a kind of alternate retelling this past year. It might have even been earlier this year. It all runs together now. But just like we've seen, it's a story that's been told so many times. Would you like to see kind of them take the Aladdin route where it was like pretty kid focused? Or would you rather see something a little more? I mean, obviously, if it's Disney, they're going to have to appeal to the children. But like something maybe with a more adult twist, or if you've got Jude Law playing Captain Hook, would you like more focus on him? Like, I don't know. What do you have any preferences?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Jake.
Okay. I would love to see a Peter Pan where it's like crazy acid trip, like Wonderland style thing. I think that would be really, because that's a direction that they haven't gone yet. I think that Hook is such, the Captain Hook is like such a villain that you can construct in that way to make him crazy and make him outlandish and make him flamboyant and execute.
And you can also make him like very evil. You can make him like super dastardly.
Exactly. Yeah, no, for sure. But the first thing that comes to mind, it's funny because we were just talking about the Far Cry games, is like Far Cry 4 with that game, the world is so crazy. The world, it's so colorful. It is like the acid trip world where a lot of crazy stuff is going on. And I think if they really lean into the magic there, they lean into the sort of the kind of dangers and the mystical island that it brings, and then leaning heavily into that stuff would be really like almost sort of like a Tim Burton-esque style world like that, I think would be really interesting. And it's something that we haven't seen in the Peter Pan space.
Yeah, I think I would definitely be on board with that. I think as someone who loved a ghost story, I haven't seen Pete's Dragon, which is, so this is going to be the second live action Disney film that David Lauer has actually done. So I assume that first movie would probably inform this in some way, but you know, from what we've seen of the Green Knight so far, and like what I've the script that I read, like you could definitely do some like trippy, as you said, kind of like psychedelic type of stuff, like visuals, just the way he approaches kind of the design and the character of Hook, for example, that would be really cool. I think if you really want to do something totally different from what's come before, that would definitely be the route to go. I think that would be cool. Do I think that's necessarily what's going to happen? Probably not.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think it would probably be something a little more in line with Pete's Dragon, where from what I've seen and heard, it's just kind of like a kind of whimsical, a little more like fantastical kind of, but blended with reality in some sort of way, which is kind of what a ghost story is to some extent. But that's kind of what I think is what it's going to end up being, for better.
I'm interested to see if it's going to be like the full-on like origin story of like Peter and Wendy meeting and all of that, or you know, because like I mean that's another thing that's been like the time within Peter Pan. I mean he never dies, but like within his lifetime, but like whether it's him as like if everyone else is older and he's still a young boy, or if it's like the start of everything, and then they try and do a sequel and a third movie, and so
yeah,
I wouldn't put that past them. But not, I mean, it's gonna be there's still so much up in the air that we'll have to keep track of moving forward. But we've got one last piece of news. Enough Peter Pan talk. This is one that I'm going to mainly let you guys handle because of your DC stand-up. But Gotham PD series. You like that?
That was stand-up. Good. That was good. I like that.
Gotham PD series set in the world of Matt Reeves, the Batman, has been ordered at HBO Max. This will be, I mean, it's getting a lot of comparisons to the show Gotham, but I mean, this is going to be set in that world. It sounds like they're going to use some footage that was not necessarily didn't make the final cut of the movie, just combining everything together, expanding this new Batman universe across multiple platforms with TV, with film. So what are your reactions? I'm turning it over to you guys.
Johnny, you got it. Copaganda, baby.
Okay. Well, first up, my immediate reaction when I saw this news was, hell yeah, for one. Because the Batman, I think I can speak for a lot of people when I say it's one of the most anticipated films of the next couple of years. A lot of people love Matt Reeves, what he did with the Planet of the Apes trilogy. A lot of people love Batman, obviously. And Robert Pattinson, I think, is a casting choice who, as we've seen more and more of him and heard more and more of what they're doing with him, is really, really exciting. But what we don't know at this point too much, or what we have seen too much of at this point, is the world itself, what Gotham's going to look like or feel like. And I think obviously you can set that up and build that in one, you know, feature film, which is what they're going to try to do in the Batman. But as Matt Reeves said in the press release for this, he wants to tell stories in this world and expand the world in a way that can only be done with long format, which however many episodes we're going to get out of this, whether it be a season, two seasons or more. I think it's a really smart choice. And the people involved is the second thing, because you see the headline, you're like, okay, that sounds really cool. Then when you hear, you know, Dylan Clark, who's the producer of the last couple of Planet of the Apes movies, and is also producing The Batman, he's going to be on executive producing with Matt Reeves. And then Terrence Winter is the real X factor in this, because he's writing the whole show from what they've said so far. He's executive producing as well. He has 12 Emmy nominations and 4 wins for The Sopranos. He created Boardwalk Empire, and he got an Oscar nomination for the screenplay for The Wolf of Wall Street, which he adapted. So I think this, he's incredibly talented, super accomplished. He's told stories in this vein before, from what I know of Boardwalk Empire, which kind of deals with corruption, especially with the police. And that's another factor that kind of came after this news came out, which was...
Oh, read the room, you know, DC.
Read the room, HBO. And Jake, I've kind of hit on what my thoughts were about the show itself. What do you kind of think, A, about the show, and then B, the negative reaction, or the you know, the vocal minority, I would say, with regards to the actual content?
First reaction to the show, same as you, home run hit. I mean, holy smokes. Like, just the crew that they got together. Matt Reeves made one of my favorite movies ever, one of the most affecting emotional blockbusters ever released, with War for the Apes, and dealt with such deep, existential, thematic, societal, resonant themes throughout that, like, one, I mean with just the Batman in general, with the film, I mean, they're paying such an astute, exact detail and attention to the graphic novels, which, and the comics, which is like the way to go when you're telling Batman, just because the best stories lies in the literature. And like shooting in Glasgow, shooting in these different places, having the Gothic look, having the Gothic feel is exactly what we're looking for. And just sort of kind of like leading into the negative response, like, I mean, like your tweet said about War for the Planet of the Apes, you know, he's not a patriot. Like, this is not going to be propaganda. He told a story central, like focusing on corrupt, militant, psychotic patriots or expatriates that have no remorse for anything else. And the sheer like notion that he would do anything other than take a deep, hard look at corruption in the police system, corruption in the police force in the world of Gotham, which is second only to Bloodhaven in the DC world in terms of utter and complete destruction and corruption, that he would try to glorify or glamorize that is just preposterous to me. And even with Terrence Winter, I mean, he, you know, Wolf of Wall Street, The Sopranos, Boardwalk Empire, none of that like screams to me like this guy's gonna be like, let's make Blue Bloods. I mean, you know, like nothing in this equation adds up to this being a propaganda show.
Right. And two other things I want to hit on real quick. First, regarding the backlash, Matt Reeves, and this is not just assumptions we're making, it's, he has said already specifically about the Batman before this news even came out, was that it's going to be a politically driven film. It's going to be reflective of the times we're living in. I mean, from what we have heard so far and what we know about the casting and everything, this movie is going to take place during an election, essentially, for the mayor of Gotham. With a bunch of different candidates, a bunch of different things going on with that. So that's obviously going to be a big part of the world he's building. Jeffrey Wright is playing Jim Gordon in the movie. We don't know yet how much he may or may not be in this show, if at all. He already has ties to HBO through Westworld, so I think that could be an interesting look, even if it's just some small appearances. But yeah, I think Matt Reeves has said that he wants to reflect things that are going on. He wants to talk about social issues. And use the Batman as a huge platform to do that. And I think that's what he did with Planet of the Apes. And I think that's something he's going to continue to do. And that's kind of what he's about. And then secondly, last thing I want to say is just HBO Max. Right now, they're still getting, you know, their legs out. They're getting up in the air. I have it already. I love it. Their library is insane. But the original content that they have in the pipeline for the rest of the year, next year, and then the year after that, and the year after that is insane. The day before this, they announced the Scenes from a Marriage miniseries with Michelle Williams and Oscar Isaac, who are both incredibly talented. That's a really cool film or property from, you know, Bergman, who they're going to adapt it from. So they have just so much stuff going on, and this is just another thing to get excited about. And I'm really excited to see Matt Reeves, who has a deal with them, to put this out and to do other projects.
I do have a question that you think that I want to pose, that now we know that the Batman just recently got back to work filming. Mm-hmm. So do you think that now with this knowledge out there that you were talking about, you don't know if Jeffrey Wright's going to be involved. Do you think they'll like take Jeffrey Wright, take Pattinson aside for a couple minutes and be like, okay, we're going to shoot this scene, put it in the vault so that we can bring it back out in season two of our show on HBO. Like, because I feel like that, like while you're there, I mean, I don't know what the procedure is like, but like while you're there, might as well, we'll just take a couple extra takes of this scene, you know, just in case. And like, I feel like that'd probably be easier to have access to them then than like, okay, he's off doing another project. Let's bring him back in to shoot a scene for a show.
Yeah. I mean, you definitely can't rule anything out at this point. The only thing I would say that would possibly prevent them from doing that is, one, they still have to film the movie, and right, they are on a time crunch, and there is COVID to worry about. So they don't know when and if things could get shut down and all that. And B, they haven't written this show yet, presumably. So they may not have characters. They may not have a story. They may not know how much they can or cannot have these characters in the show. So I wouldn't be surprised if they did some sort of thing on the side to get them more, you know, involved. But who knows? I mean, I'm excited either way. But
makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, I would say similar to what Johnny. Maybe they would film like promo stuff for the show while filming the Batman. Just like maybe they would say this. Just like act out this scene, do this so we can put it up on a trailer or put it up on like a quick release look. But
yeah,
in terms of the show itself, like Johnny said, I don't think that they've actually gone about figuring out what exactly it's going to be yet. And just in terms
maybe of just bank stuff, some generic like stock footage type stuff.
Just some promo stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could see that happening. So that's it for news. Really solid haul, a lot of interesting stuff to talk through. And now it's time to move on to our doubleheader streaming review. We're gonna start off with The Old Guard and then follow up with Palm Springs because we want to get the divisive stuff out of the way first. So, The Old Guard.
Who are you?
You can call me Andy.
I lead a group of soldiers. Fighters. Like you. With an extremely rare skill set.
What do you mean?
Mother? Let's just say we're very hard to kill.
You've got questions, kid. You want answers?
Borders, what's up with that?
I have the new one.
What's up with that?
And?
I think she has potential. See, you're already healing faster. You're gonna do great.
So you good guys or bad guys?
Depends on the century.
So we really never die.
Just because we keep living doesn't mean we stop hurting.
Throughout history, we've protected this world, fighting in the shadows. But it's nearly impossible to disappear in the world we live in today.
These are extraordinary individuals. They are extremely resistant to capture.
They're going to lock us up and weaponize us. But they've never faced an army like ours.
An army of five. Shit, let's start a band.
This is the new Netflix original action film directed by Gina Prince Bythewood. It's based on the 2017 graphic novel of the same name. Starring Charlize Theron, Kiki Layne, Marwan Kenzari, Luca Marinelli, Harry Melling, and Chiwetel Ejiofor. Currently holds an 80%, baby. 80% on Rotten Tomatoes, 76% audience score, 70 Metacritic score. But I am here with two haters.
Hey, what's that average looking like?
I'm not a hater.
Okay, yeah, let me correct that. I liked it.
I'm a certified
hater. Jake approved of it. Didn't feel one way or another. It was there. And then Johnny pretty down on it. So it's going to be an interesting discussion here today. We've got all different kinds of opinions at it. So before we get started, little plot synopsis here. Jake, take it away.
Johnny, you're going to get to hear my narrated voice.
Hey, I've been ready to see this live.
All right, here we go. Led by a warrior named Andy, played by Charlize Theron, a covert group of tight-knit mercenaries with a mysterious inability to die have fought to protect the moral world for centuries. But when the team is recruited to take on an emergency mission and their extraordinary abilities are suddenly exposed, it's up to Andy and Niall, played by Kiki Layne, the newest soldier, to join their ranks, help the group eliminate the threat of those who seek to replicate and monetize their power by any means necessary.
Boom, boom, boom. Nicely done. Nicely done.
Nice.
Killer.
So with this being three of us here reviewing, we're going to do a little bit different instead of just diving right in. We will each give somewhat of like an opening statement, just general thoughts on the movie before we get down into some specifics. So we're going to go in order from most liked to most disliked. So I'm going to start things off by saying that I really enjoyed this movie more than I thought I would. I went in expecting fancy action, big set pieces, which there definitely were. Those were impressive, but I didn't expect the story to be as compelling or the performances to be as strong as what we ended up getting. I know Johnny's going to refute that, but I thought that was the case. I had a few minor nitpicks, mainly the strange use of techno EDM style electronica music in between scenes. But for the most part, pretty much everything worked for me. Or during, yes. This is my opening statement, sir. I thought this movie was a lot of fun, even beyond just those spectacular set pieces and like the unique fighting style, blending the old, like old timey swords and axes and new weapons. I thought there was a lot of lore and mythology to be explored. This film barely scratched the surface of what I anticipate seeing a lot more of in what seems like it'll be a new franchise for Netflix to explore. So I'm very excited about that. I gave it a 4 out of 5 stars, 81 out of 100. I enjoyed this movie and I will defend it. I'm not saying it's the best movie in the entire world, my favorite movie ever, but it was a good time for me.
Solid. I thought it was fine. I mean, I thought it was fine. I thought it was passable. I thought they did some really interesting stuff, and not like interesting in a condescending way. I thought that
ambitious.
No. Yeah. I mean, like I think conceptually it's a really cool idea. Greg Rucka with the original 2017 graphic novel. My father had read it. He really liked it. Conceptually, it's really cool. Charlize Theron is a badass by all accounts. I wasn't super high on Atomic Blonde, but she was freaking visceral in that movie. And they make some really interesting choices with her in that movie too. And I think that here she kind of felt a little bit constrained. I don't know if it was just her performance was supposed to be a little bit more measured, a little bit more silent, but I just wasn't getting the sort of gripping nature that I usually get from her, especially in these movies, which she loves to do. The EDM music really threw me off.
Khaled at the end.
I was shocked. Yeah. They made some strange choices that didn't work for me. I thought the action was fine. Some of the set pieces were really cool. I didn't think that they did enough. I don't think they played into the immortality aspect of it enough when it came to the action. It's like we saw it happen and then we saw them talk about it. But when it came to the actual fighting of it, apropos of the first encounter, it was really just them being fast and them being strong. And it wasn't necessarily, I don't think they played into it enough to make interesting. But yeah, I mean, I thought it was fine. I thought there were some good moments in it. I don't regret watching it. I don't really know if I'll like be back for the sequel, but you know, it's just, you know, it was fun.
There you go.
Quick question before Johnny. I jump into mine. Your dad, did he watch it with you, or did he watch it? Did he like it?
So he liked it more. He actually did. Okay. And I think that having the attachment to the comic probably does that for someone. And he said it was a faithful adaption. So, you know, take that however you will. But yeah, I mean, just overall, I thought that they did some cool things, but it wasn't enough of a complete film in terms of pacing, in terms of story, in terms of structure, narrative form, function, whatever it may be, for me to like fully invest in what was happening outside of seeing people get killed.
I'm pretty much, I think this is a really good, it's been a great spread, because I am on the total opposite spectrum from Zach. You're kind of dead in the middle. I didn't have any expectations for this. If I wasn't reviewing it, I would never have watched it on my own. But I was game for kind of a fun concept. It's, you know, driven action film with Charlize Theron, who we all love. She's badass. And the cast, I think that they assembled, and the characters in this are really unique. And that, especially for action films, you don't usually see. I mean, there's a gay couple in the team. One of the leads is, you know, a Black woman. So that was, you know, different from the usual. I mean, we've gotten how many John Wicks now where it's Keanu Reeves just beating the shit out of guys over and over again. But unfortunately, it just, like you said, it never came together for me at all. But more so, it was just, it felt so uninspired. You know, I love Greg Rucka's work with Wonder Woman from the comics I've read with him, but this was his first live action feature film screenplay. It just felt really, you know, cliche with a lot of the lines. The story was kind of, you know, clunky. And you know, I feel like a lot of times action films get put in two different categories. You can be, you know, really more focused on characters, get a lot of depth out of them, maybe not focus so much on the action. Or it could be, you know, guns blazing, spectacle. Characters don't really matter that much. And for me, it felt like this one was neither of those. It was just kind of bleh. And everything about it just fell flat.
I can agree with that last part. Not like the bleh part, but just like it is kind of somewhat in the middle of like the your two definitions of what action movies can be. I mean, I agree with that. There wasn't like, I enjoyed the action and the set pieces, but it wasn't like they were the sole focus of just like, we're going to make these. I haven't seen it, but like what I've heard about like Six Underground, like that's Michael Bay. Just like, let's make like, let's blow stuff up and make super cool stunts. Like almost like Hobbs and Shaw. That's a better example for like something that I've seen. Like that's just like absurdity, super like super star, like explosions and everything like that. So, I mean, but then like, obviously like a Mission Impossible Fallout, which is more like character driven. And that's like a one we all agree is a masterpiece. So I agree with that, that it kind of falls in between here and doesn't really fit either of those categories, but that didn't like, obviously from what I just said, it doesn't like take this movie down any for me.
Yeah. I mean, I think Johnny made a sharp note. The Achilles heel of this film, in my opinion, just in terms of from what I saw, it was, like we've talked about, it was just so unsure of itself, you know, because at some moments it really felt like it was going to be the breakneck pace, and then some moments it slowed down, and I think it became disjointed because of that, because it was trying so hard in moments to establish who these people were, and then that kind of went to the wayside in some moments where they were just tools and utilities to focus on something, and just not necessarily the withdrawal, but the inability to play into either of those enough to make it something that what it was. I mean, like we've talked about, The Night Comes for Us on Netflix is breakneck, unbelievable,
literally.
Full throttle action. literally breakneck, full throttle action throughout. And it does a really nice job of having those deft character moments that land. And I think with this, it kind of felt like we were on a freeway with red lights, you know, like we would go and then we would stop for like 2 minutes and like figure this out. And then we'd go again and then we'd have to keep stopping. And it didn't necessarily click for me.
Yeah. You mentioned, you know, deft character moments, which is a good point. For me, they went for character moments. There's a good little cast of characters here. for me, none of them ever really connected or felt genuine, maybe. Like there's a scene that the Netflix account has posted already on Twitter with the, I think it's Nikki and
the couple,
boyfriend's name. Yeah. So there's a gay couple. They are
Nikki and Joe.
Nikki and Joe. So Nikki and Joe, there's a really like lovey, like almost cheesy scene between them where they're one of them is kind of saying, you know, how much he loves this guy and how much he cares about him, which is, you know, that's great. But like, for me, it just felt like, this is so like kind of contrived.
Are you talking about the not my boyfriend monologue?
Yes. When he's talking, they're kind of, yes, they're in a van with some bad guys. And they're like in a position where they're like insulting them and just making disparaging comments and being derogatory. And he kind of gives this little speech. And then it ends with like a kiss and everything. It's like really sweet, but it was just like, it didn't feel genuine. Like that, those two in particular, while I like what they tried to do, it just felt like, and this is something I think I might've written in my review. I want to hear what you guys thought about this. These guys were crusaders. One of them was a crusader during the literal crusades, hundreds of years ago. One of them was in the Middle East, you know, defending, you know, the Holy Land. They kill each other. And then they allude to the fact that they kill each other over and over again. And then, of course, we realize that they become lovers and they have been together as a couple for all this time. But it doesn't really explain how they transitioned from hating each other and being mortal, like holy enemies, to being lovers, and, you know, what that has been like for this whole time. It just kind of felt like, okay, they were here. And then it's like this kind of funny, don't think about it for more than 5 seconds, idea of how they got together. And then now they're here and they're just a great couple. And
yeah. See, I didn't take issue with that. Well, first of all, I liked the scene. You didn't connect with it, that scene, I guess, but I liked that scene. I like wrote down in my notes, like that not my boyfriend monologue was excellent. But like, I didn't take issue with that backstory there just because of the, like, there's a lot to work through here. Like a lot of the lore and mythology of like how this universe works, who these people are, how long they've been around. And I think it's clear that they're trying to turn this into a franchise. And so like, for me, like with that in mind, like I'm totally fine. Okay. We're learning like the basics, the fundamentals of this world here. Like someone like a John Wick, we've made that comparison. Like John Wick 1, it's like mainly just like him kicking ass and taking names. And then John Wick 2, it's like, okay, here's everything you need to know about this world and how it operates. And so like with that, I mean, obviously we get that teaser at the end, kind of like the cliffhanger to set up for the second one with Quinn returning. But I think that like you also have the unique ability here to, if it weren't for that cliffhanger, like movie 2 in this series could be set in the Crusades, or it could be like, because these people have been around for so long, it doesn't necessarily have to go like in chronological order. And even if it does move forward with the second one, you could still like have more explanation or scenes or flashbacks from a different time period and where we might end up getting that answer.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't, I guess kind of the only explanation that would make sense in my mind is that, you know, people only die once. So if you're dead and you wake up and someone else is there, I guess that builds a sort of camaraderie, that builds a sort of bond. And then of course that's formulated over decades and decades and centuries, which would make sense in my mind. But it's a matter of these things sticking the landing when they do these little offhand comments that obviously reveal a little bit about, or it's supposed to reveal something about the character, about the backstory. And, you know, we keep talking about John Wick. One of my favorite moments in the first John Wick movie is when, after he goes through all the people in his apartment or in his house, and the police officer comes up to him and is like, "Working again, John?" Like, that is a great moment, you know, because that's the type of stuff that like lands perfectly. And a lot of stuff in John Wick and John Wick 2, when they're setting stuff up, really works like that. When they do those little comments, when they do those little motions, movements, and you're like, there is a relationship here, there's a connection here, there's something that's been built, and they don't need to do monologues for us to understand that. You know, it's just, it's four words. You working again, John? These people know each other. These people have a relationship. It's uneasy. You can tell by the motion, you can tell by the movement, and that stuff really worked for me. Whereas in the old guard, when they tried to do things like that, it some of it did land, but ultimately not enough for me to make it as compelling as I would have liked it to be.
Yeah. And I just want to, you know, talk about the action a little bit. It's being marketed and is being talked about like it is an action movie. It's a big action movie. It's on Netflix. Charlize Theron, who's a big action star. And like we say, it kind of falls in between these two, you know, ends where it doesn't really have enough action, in my opinion. You know, for I'm asking you guys right now, what are the big action set pieces in this movie?
I mean, I think that not really like a big set piece, but like one of the better action scenes is that like the fight on the plane between the two of them. And then you get the church shootout, which is more of a big one. You get that initial, the very first scene when they're like making that raid and then get shot up.
Yeah. And then the final battle. I would say that there's only three. It's just a beginning, middle, and end where you get those set pieces.
I want to say there's something that you, in your written review, you were talking about like the
plane scene, by the way.
Ugh. Well, okay.
You gotta talk about this.
No, but talking about like the action, like, you're questioning like the decision to use like old weapons versus
that's another thing I just can't fathom,
but like
the sense behind it.
I mean, yeah, sure, there's not like sense behind it, but I mean, when you can't die, I mean, I know they still say that they can feel pain and stuff, but like I thought that like visually, though, whether sense aside, like that it made like it was entertaining to watch, to like see that blend of like,
right,
if it's just like a gun shootout, like it's not necessary. I mean, you can make it exciting like John Wick, but
yeah,
but okay, like if it's just like two people undercover like popping out shooting back and forth at each other, like to use that other style to like and blend them together, because they're not exclusively using swords and stuff.
No, I definitely get that, and I that's kind of what I said in my review. I was like, or on Twitter, you know, it looks cool, and it's like, oh wow, she has like a battle axe and she's fighting these you know, this like SWAT team essentially. But, you know, you talk about the sense or the logic of it. I mean, Greg Rucka made this. They wrote the movie. I mean, they could have changed things or added things to make it make sense. Like, there's no pre-established rules. It's all make-believe. So, you know, people love Deadpool and Deathstroke and those kinds of characters because they're superhuman. They, you know, they can't be killed, essentially. They have swords. They just cut through guys like crazy. They use machine guns, all these other things. In the Old Guard, they cannot die. They can feel pain. They specifically talk about many times how painful it is, how they go through it over and over again. It takes a while to heal, especially if you're an older person who's had the power for a while. To me, it just doesn't, you know, apart from the visual or the aesthetic, in the world, there's just no logic or consistency with why they would ever even want to use anything that is not the most effective way of,
if you're 10,000 years old, I'm sure she has some sort of attachment to that axe, you know? She can keep it around.
Yeah, just hang it on the wall.
Yeah, and like, especially, you know, they talk about we can lose this power at any time and we don't know when or why. So if you'd have that knowledge, wow, if I get shot like this badly or something like this happens, I might not be able to come back, or it could just happen randomly. Why would you put yourself at much more risk? And yeah, especially Deathstroke and Deadpool, the guys I bring up with the superpowers, and regeneration, all that, they, you know, they use those weapons and they can heal and they do all those things, but they have superhuman speed, senses, agility, all these things where if they're using bladed weapons, that kind of stuff, it doesn't matter because they can jump around guys, get to them before they can even, you know, breathe essentially. Whereas with these people, they never say anything about powers beyond regeneration. They are normal as far as strength and speed and all those things, at least to the audience's knowledge. So they don't have any sort of advantage tactically other than they can swing it well, or they have experience from the hundreds of years of being in the Crusades or whatever else they've done.
Yeah.
So just for me, it sounds nitpicky or details, but that kind of stuff, little things here and there, you know, is what doesn't allow me to sink into the world or really appreciate it. Cause I'm just like, okay, but why? Yeah. Why are they choosing to do that?
And it's I think it's a difficult task to be able to move, like do hand to hand, do sword play, do blunt and sharp objects in a contemporary space when you're dealing with an action movie, because of course the first choice is a gun. With The Night Comes for Us, just speaking back to that, there are guns throughout the film, that people get shot, people get killed with guns, but it's more of a commodity within the set piece when it happens. You know, if they're fighting in a kitchen, there are no guns around, there are not, you know, things like that. The conventions make sense because it's not like, like eight people have guns and this guy has a swordfish and then 30 seconds later, everyone else ends up on the ground. But it's almost like when a gun is pulled in the set piece, it's as if everyone is surprised. And I think that when you're dealing with conventions like that, when you make it in such a way that that makes more sense, that it's much more believable that someone would choose a butcher knife over a pistol, you know?
Right.
I get that. I mean, I am not challenging the common sense behind it, but it wasn't something that like impacted my viewing experience so significantly.
It does look cool. Also, I mean, I get why people like it.
Yeah.
Also talking about the action, another thing that I really liked about this was like the whole teamwork vibe of everything.
I really like that. Yeah.
We've talked about Deadpool a bit. We've talked about John Wick. Those are movies where it is just
one guy,
the single person just like absolutely dominating and taking everybody out. But I think that the team, the group effort here of having five or six people working together, it allowed for a lot of creativity within the action. Just like it made it more, the choreography was more like dancing than acting, because it's like working, how they work off of each other, work well together. So I mean, I just think that that's something that another thing that made the action sequences more exciting to me.
I mean, the teamwork,
I like that aspect too.
The teamwork for me was honestly, I think, the most effective part of the film. And it was something that really landed, because it's something that we're watching and they don't need to say, even though they do multiple times, that like they've been together for all this time, like we're watching them fight together, and obviously they've done these moves before,
they know how each other operates.
They know that one person will go low, one person will go high, one person is fast, one person is slower, and you see all that that is executed really effectively, just in terms of how they groove together. And that was one of the most effective pieces of this film, is just their ability to the ability of the stunt choreographers and the director to be able to show us that these people have been working together for quite some time.
And no, I definitely agree with that. I mean, I liked how it does, like, as you said, Zach, it's not just one guy like John Wick or Deadpool carving through everyone. It's these people working together, setting up moves. They each have, you know, somewhat varied abilities and kind of like what they specialize in. Yeah, as someone who is on the negative spectrum of this and feels like I kind of have to like just ask questions or like kind of defend like where I'm coming from, I want to hear two things that kind of stood out to me. Again, just little details that I just didn't understand why they didn't change it to make it a little bit different or make it more like make sense more. So you talked about the plane scene, which is a pivotal scene in the movie, because it's just after Charlize Theron's character, Andy, she abducts Niles. Or Niall, and she takes
Niles
her
is later. Niles is later.
Niles is later. Yeah, isn't that weird? In the same week.
I know. That was something I pointed out.
But Niall Freeman is Kiki Layne's character, and she is a Marine. She's in the U.S. Marines. She gets when she gains the power, she gets taken by Charlize Theron. They have a little back and forth. They're on the airplane, and there's this scene, part of the scene on the airplane where there's like this fun, clever little trick that they do, and it comes back later in the film where Charlize Theron, she knows Russian, and she's communicating with the pilot, essentially. And she pretends to shoot the pilot in order to leverage the situation to get Niall to work with her and not be so standoffish. So the pilot is seemingly dead. Andy pulls out her gun, shoots him, he slumps over, the plane's about to crash. And then it's revealed Andy told him in Russian to play dead. And then so he gets back up, he pulls the plane up, everything's fine. And then her and Niall kind of face off real quick. But I just, you know, when you're following the situation, she pulls out the gun, she shoots him. I thought he was dead. I mean, the gun went off, he slumps over. There's no blood splatter. There's nothing like that. The chair doesn't get shot. What the hell happened during that scene when she shot the gun?
I think there's a very, like, simple thing that didn't, like, first of all, I didn't have that like thought process at all when it actually happened. I just thought it was cool. But then I think it circles back to it at the very end when Kiki Layne she realizes that Charlize is being set up, when there's the whole she finds the gun, opens it up, and sees that there's blanks in it, And for me, that was like enough. It was like, okay, so that's what happened early. Like, I don't know. It obviously is never explicitly stated why she had blanks in that gun.
Was it blanks or was there just no rounds in it? Because I thought it was just empty.
I mean, I don't know gun terminology that well, so I can't speak on that.
I know the part you're referencing, and that was interesting, the way they set up that character twist. But I mean, that gun was empty as far as I could see. And in this scene, I mean, the gun goes off, there's muzzle flash and everything. So unless she had literal blanks in there, which they never address or talk about, I'm like, why would she have that? Was she prepared to shoot someone and pretend that they were dead? For me, it was just like, okay, it looks cool, it's funny, you don't think about it after it's over. But for me, I was just like, what, like, how did that even get set up? Like, what was the logic there? So I don't, Jake, did you have any sort of like reaction or think anything weird about that?
I mean, I thought it was strange because I thought he was dead too.
Right, yeah.
I thought it was dead too.
Even though there's no blood splatter or anything.
Yeah, and it's like, so if the gun was empty, like, then she would have known and she wouldn't have given Kiki Lane the empty gun. And she would have known that she was being set up, you know. But if she didn't know that there were guns in it, then I feel like if she didn't know that there were rounds in it, then because it seems like she shot him straight on. I feel like she would have been surprised if there was the bullet was no
right,
like,
right. There's no like
the window. It didn't hit the roof. It didn't.
Yeah.
Hit the
there's no blood or anything.
Yeah. So
it's just like I said. For me, it's like, it sounds nitpicky, and I'm not trying to be a dick. If you enjoyed it, that's awesome. But I mean, because it is funny and clever in the moment. You're like, oh wow, she really got her. Like,
it's a minor thing of no consequence, but it is a little bit strange.
But the fact that it's like, okay, they do it so quickly, it completely changes the scene around, and then it's just like, okay, but how exactly did they do that? It's just like, it just pulled me out of it. And it's kind of similar. The other thing I wanted to talk about was Kiki Lane's character. She's in the Marines, and she's like an infantry person. They're on a mission when she gets killed, obviously. And it was just like, she was badass, and obviously she was capable, but just like the way she went from being like a seemingly normal soldier who didn't want to be involved in any of this like crazy shit that was going on. And then she just like went toe to toe with Andy, who's like 10,000 years old and is like the best fighter on the planet. Or the fact that later on, she's doing like all these John Wick style, like close quarter combat things, which for someone, I guess, who maybe knows more about the military or comes from military family and stuff, like no one would ever do that. Like if they're just a standard Marine, like in the Marine Corps. And like, she did like a John Wick. I don't know if you noticed that, Jake, I mentioned that earlier. She does like a John Wick, like single-handed, like cock and like catches it, which looks really cool. And you've seen that in John Wick and stuff. But for me, it was just like another thing that just detached me. I'm like, I mean, if she was like special, you know, forces or spec ops, like really trained and like does like shit like that all the time, it would make sense. But she wasn't given any training by the old guard. She just kind of like got picked up and went away. It was just, I don't know. It was just stuff where I was like, okay, I can get why these people are so.
I think you're digging too deep.
It's the most basic stuff, my guy. Really?
I just flipped it on. I was expecting a fun little action romp. I got what I wanted. Four stars for me. I'm not analyzing reload techniques.
Yeah. I mean, I think Johnny is onto something here, though, because the first thing that comes to mind when he says that is Into the Spider-Verse. And that's going to sound weird when I talk about it, but that's going to sound weird.
Rewatched it last night. Excellent movie.
Oh, it's a classic.
I agree. One of my favorites.
But the great thing about Into the Spider-Verse is that Miles has no training. He obviously has no training. He doesn't get much better until the very end. No, exactly. But we see the transition happen. We see the transformation happen. He goes through one of the greatest scenes in animation to be able to transition into that. And that makes us believe that he can do this stuff a lot more because they play into that. They play into the ability that he has to learn how to swing. He has to learn how to do all these different things. He has to believe in himself. He has to be confident. And he's improvising and working his way through on the fly. And we never get enough of that with Kiki Lane to it. Cause I was confused too when she started, because it's like with the Matrix, Neo downloads the program and he's good to go. You know, and like that makes sense for us. But all they did was talk to her. Like they never showed her how to shoot a gun. They never showed her how to counter. They never showed her how to do any of this stuff. To like, maybe it's just stuff that comes with the powers that were just weren't explained. But at the same time, I'm like,
I mean, I feel like there's probably some sort of like the same way that I'm sure you can probably find some sort of explanation within the graphic novels and more of that.
Yeah.
But
yeah, for sure.
I mean, I feel like the same way that like, okay, she died and that is what like started this. That's what like made everything click to bring her back to life. That's what, where everyone else got these visions of her. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that there's some sort of like triggering within like, okay, now this is acknowledged. Mm-hmm. Now you're being enhanced in this way, this way, that way.
Okay. This is the last thing I'm going to say about it. Cause I, that is a good point to make. The one thing I would say, Greg Rucka, who wrote the graphic novel, he wrote the screenplay for this. So if there is some extra information, again, he could do or say anything he wanted in the script. And I think if there was other details he could have added to clarify things or just to make it make more sense, he should have. And secondly, I read in the notes from Netflix that they released, he wrote the first draft. And one of the big notes he got was that Niall wasn't a strong enough character, that they wanted to flesh out a little bit more. They wanted to give her more agency, which is another issue I had with the film. Cause her, you know, I love Kiki Layne. She was great. And if Beale Street could talk, which, you know, go watch that. But she doesn't do a lot on her own or make a ton of decisions until the very end. And again, if they had just given her a little bit more, like shown her doing some training or something, or if they had just rewriting the script or changing the script around, made her a more badass person before she got killed, make her, you know, spec ops, make her someone in the CIA or someone that has like intense combat training, hand to hand guns, all this different stuff, she would have been a better character, and B, she would have been a better fighter. It would have just made more logical sense. And I think, again, change any little thing you want, but if you're already being told, hey, this character needs more work, she needs to be improved, I think that's something that they easily could have done. And that's something, even if they go to a sequel, they should do more with her, flesh her out more, give her more weapons, to use a phrase. But
you just got to wait to check out the deleted scenes on the Criterion DVD when it comes out.
The director's commentary.
All right. So pretty divisive on the old guard. We hope that somebody in this group here related to what you were feeling about this movie.
I'm sure they
hopefully
did.
We had the full spectrum of opinions here, but I think the next one here that we're about to talk about, this doubleheader, we're all pretty on board. So Palm Springs.
It's gonna be a beautiful wedding.
Here you are, standing on the precipice of something so much bigger than anyone here. But always remember, you are not alone.
I don't think that we met. I'm Sarah.
Niles.
Hi.
Hi.
Nice.
What the fuck is happening?
Run, rabbit, run. Time
after time. Niles?
Don't come in here.
What the?
It's gonna be a beautiful wedding.
Good day so far? Today, tomorrow, it's all the same.
You! What is going on? Hey, get out of the water!
Guess you followed me. It's one of those infinite time loop situations you might have heard about.
That I might have heard about?
Yeah.
Another new original streaming movie, original rom-com directed by Max Barbacow on Hulu, which is being distributed by Neon as well. Neon with just absolute bangers across the board with Parasite, with Portrait, with Shirley was pretty good too. I mean, it's just, they've gotten some really good stuff recently. But so here we go. We got Andy Samberg, Kristen Milioti, and J.K. Simmons holding it down. Currently at 92% on Rotten Tomatoes, 90% audience score, 84 on Metacritic. And like I said, pretty much adored across the board for all of us. I think that's a pretty safe thing to say here.
Absolutely.
Agree.
Jake, take it away.
Yeah, I loved it. I did.
No. Plot summary, sir.
Oh, my bad. Oh, yes, I got it. Here we go. We're ready. I got ahead of myself. I read the opening statement. I got excited. All right, here we go. When carefree Niles, played by Andy Samberg, and reluctant maid of honor, Sarah, played by Kristen Milioti, has a chance encounter at Palm Springs' wedding, things get complicated when they find themselves unable to escape the venue, themselves or each other.
Da-da-da. There we go.
Now, excellent. Yes. I loved it. I didn't watch the trailer when Johnny sent it in our group chat. I watched like the first few seconds. So I was like, I kind of want to be surprised. And I just knew that it was the Groundhog thing or Groundhog Day thing. But coming into it, I love Andy Samberg, Kristen Milioti. I love her and everything that she's done. She's great in How I Met Your Mother. And I think after this, she really deserves to be in more stuff because she is just amazing. And it's great. I mean, it's heartfelt. It's funny. The emotional moments land really well. There's some really surprising performances in there. J.K. Simmons, I think, is a treasure, and just because of his versatility and what he's able to do. But when you're dealing with sort of existential problems, when you're dealing with the fact of, like, when people are coming to grips with nihilism, when people are coming to grips with sort of like hopelessness, and when you're trapped in a lane where you think you can never escape, they do some really interesting choices, because this is something that they talk about, where this has been done many a time, most notably in Groundhog Day. And to be able to do something that's done so much and that's been done so often in so many different ways and so many different mediums, and make it your own, make it singular, make it unique and interesting, is exactly what they did. I thought that and their chemistry together was phenomenal. I mean, they were just brilliant together. The love felt real, the affection felt real, the pain felt real, and everything about this film was exciting, was endearing, was evocative. And I think that it's also indicative that everybody that worked on this, from the writer to the director to the actors, it's going to be exciting to see where they go next and what they do next. And I was such a huge fan of this. It's lovely. It's wonderful. It's only 89 minutes too. So if you have Hulu,
a crisp 90, we love it.
Definitely check it out. And it was the most expensive purchase at Sundance ever, coming in at 17 million and 69 cents.
So, nice.
Which is very nice. Funny. But yeah, it's great. I loved it.
I totally agree with everything you just said. Very well said. I didn't know what to expect. I knew it was Groundhog Day scenario. And I did watch the trailer, which I didn't really remember that much from it. I just knew it looked really funny. With these, I haven't seen Pop Star with Andy Samberg, which is kind of another lonely
sin. Shame.
I know. Shame. But I remember Hot Rod from years and years ago, which I loved when I was a kid. That was just hilarious. But with these, it's kind of, you don't know if they're just going to kind of do a feature length SNL skit where they just get like this kind of one really funny concept and just kind of drive it into the ground, especially with a shorter movie.
Like MacGruber.
Yeah, even though I've never seen that, I would never watch that. But I thought, hey, this could still be funny. I'm sure it'll be worthwhile. But they really did, as Jake pointed out, get a lot of like great, I mean, there were great performances in this, legitimately like compelling drama, and the characters are fleshed out. There's great character work. There are a lot of, for a concept that has been done, I've never seen Groundhog Day. I still need to watch it. It's on my Netflix list last time I checked. But I have seen Edge of Tomorrow, which I love. I've seen Happy Death Day. And so this was still really surprising in all the right ways. They did a lot of interesting moves with the characters, with the relationships, not only between each other, but he's in a relationship with his girlfriend he's trying to get out of. She is the maid of honor, the sister of the bride. They have an interesting dynamic, including the fiance, the groom. And just all these different details, because their family's crammed in here at this wedding. And that's what the genius part of this is. It is set at a wedding. So there's a lot you can do with the romance. There's a lot of stuff you can do with the comedy, obviously. And just the dynamics between everyone. The chemistry, again, like I said, is fantastic between the two leads. And out of the three new releases I saw this week, the Old Guard, this, and First Cow, which I liked a lot. Go watch that if you're interested. But this was the one that I enjoyed the most and I thought was my favorite.
With you. I'm with both of you guys. I mean, I think that this was just about as charming as you could expect. When you see the trailer, I mean, it's knowing Andy Samberg, knowing Kristen Milioti, it makes you excited to see it. But I think that the comparisons to Groundhog Day and other movies where it is the time loop structure that, like you said, they openly acknowledge in the trailer, saying one of those time loop situations you might have heard about. I think those comparisons are easy to make, but they're also sloppy because there's so much more that this movie does to like bring that in. Like, sure, that's the general premise. If you've seen the trailer, you know what you're getting yourself into. But I think it's also super self-aware. It takes that into account, knowing that you, like, knowing that you've seen these other movies, it's not going to give you the same thing over and over again. And I mean, I think they do that by, okay, there's no introductory first act. You like get right down to business. It's like 15 minutes in, we're already in the time loop. We've acknowledged it. Like, you know what's happening. I think that it just like moves forward with the other ways. By doing that so quickly, it lets you move forward with the other ways to subvert the time loop genre and get away from all those tropes. I mean, they're not desperately, I mean, there's like a 5 minute stretch where Sarah is trying to escape by killing herself, getting like traveling, getting away. But I mean, it's those things, like, they address them very quickly and then move on. I mean, and then they pose the question of like, what if, sure, you're stuck in this, but what if you enjoyed every day and wanted to keep doing it over and over again? And then that, obviously that's where it starts, but then it goes deeper into their relationship between Andy Samberg and Kristen Milioti, into their relationship, their motivations. Like you guys said, both incredibly watchable duo. I mean, their chemistry is off the charts. They work extremely well together. And I agree with both of you that there's like a surprising amount of emotion here. So it's a rom-com, but there's a significant, I would call it a rom-com drama. Because there's like some pretty dramatic stuff that happens.
No,
as well.
No doubt. Andy Samberg.
Between the two of them, between Andy Samberg and J.K. Simmons. I mean, there's between Sarah and her sister. I mean, there's just an interesting balance of all three genres here. But like you said, Andy Samberg, obviously he's the leading man, the headliner here. But I think it's Kristen Milioti's movie through and through. I think she's going to be the breakout star of this. Hopefully, like Jake said, big fan of her in How I Met Your Mother at the last season. Big fan of her in the USS Callister episode of Black Mirror. So hopefully we can see her break out at last, get some more leading roles. This was a 4 out of 5 for me, 84 out of 100. I really, really enjoyed it.
Yeah. And I think just one quick thing before we break into it a little bit sooner. What we all talked about, just in terms of what we liked as just a brief overlook, it takes a lot to make a good movie.
Hell yeah.
It takes a little bit more to make a great one. And the people that go the extra mile, the people that, because it did not need to be as emotionally resonant as it was. Nope. It could have just been funny, sad, funny. You know what I'm saying? Just like, that's the typical structure for rom-coms anyway. It's like, it's very funny, it's quirky, it's sad, then it's funny again. But like they did a little bit more, they did just a little bit more to make it stand out. And one thing that I really loved, because we're talking about the time loop genre, is something that Edge of Tomorrow did brilliantly and superbly, is, and also with Palm Springs, is that they had someone in there that had been living that for quite some time. So there was no need to do the trial and error until you figure out that it's hopeless. And then you have someone in there to understand their side of it when you're looking down the barrel of a gun 10,000 days, the millionth birthday, they said, and to have that dynamic, to have someone that's like a neophyte in whatever situation towards the experienced veteran, it's a really smart choice, and it was executed supremely well in this film.
I think that the way, like Johnny mentioned it, and then you again, Jake, Edge of Tomorrow, I haven't seen it, but it's like, I feel like time loop movies.
That's a sin.
Dude, get out of here.
You can say that with literally
decade.
You can say that about 8 million movies and get me on it. So I'm over it. But so, I mean, I feel like that time loop movies they fall in the same trap of action movies a lot. Like there was the period where it was like after Die Hard, it was like Die Hard, but on a bus. Okay. You've got speed. Die Hard, but in China, you've got skyscraper. Like there's that's like a typical like trope of an action movie. And then like, with these time loop movies, you've got Groundhog, but make it scary. Okay, Happy Death Day. Groundhog, but sci-fi. Now it's like Groundhog, but rom-com. But then again, I mean, I think that that's the easy way to analyze this movie, but I think there's a lot more that we can really get into here.
Yeah. For me, I thought one of the most brilliant moves that he did, part of it is the character and his use in the film, and part of it is the actor, which of course is J.K. Simmons. This very easily could have just been one-on-one, you know, more or less between Andy Samberg and Kristen Milioti's character. But having him as someone that was, you know, an enemy of Niles, And then
it's
throughout
just
the film
so kinda, random.
I know. And it really does come out of nowhere. I mean, that's the whole, not only does he make for an interesting dynamic between Niles and himself, because they have that, it moves from antagonism to, you know, there's some sort of friendship and kind of a shared, you know, bond there through their experience. But he's the factor that causes her to get into it in the first place. If he hadn't shown up and started hunting him, he never would have gone to the cave. She never would have followed him. She never even got trapped in the time loop. So for me, he was the impetus for them, her getting stuck in it. And then at the end, the great, great conversation between him and Niles in the backyard with his kids, which is just, it's so funny, but it's so poignant at the same time, was really great. And that's kind of where we leave him. Of course, there's a little bit at the end, which was a fantastic ending and like resolution for his character. But I really like that aspect, not just between the two leads, but J.K. Simmons and his role in the film.
Yeah, I mean, I thought that was a great, I liked having that, like you mentioned, that it wasn't just one-on-one, but to have that third party in there as well to add like a different element to it. And again, obviously when you get that, the fight between the two of them, between Milioti and Sandberg, that then you have that third party to kind of bounce ideas off of and use that as the revelation that kind of helps get everything back on the right track.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the script is really sharp. The direction is really neat. They do a lot of cool and interesting things that work extremely well, but this is a performance grounded film, and the performances are stellar, because it's a difficult thing to be versatile from one movie to the next. And it's even more difficult to be versatile within the same film. Mm-hmm. And, you know, being a comedic actor is very difficult. anybody that acts will tell you that it is supremely difficult, but to be able to switch that on a dime and be dramatic or be emotional or be sad or be poignant, every single person in here, Andy Samberg, Chris Emiliotti, J.K. Simmons, their trio went through, you know, the wide scope of human emotion throughout their experiences being in the time loop, and all of it landed. I mean, all of it was effective. Every time that they were sad, we understood why. Every time that they were happy, we laughed with them. Every time that they had something to say, we listened. And that, I think that's really what makes the movie so enjoyable, is just because of the people we're watching it.
I mean, I think that a lot of it all comes back to balance, that but between the genres. Like for me, I know it's kind of going to be hard for you to answer this, Jake, as not having seen the trailer, but I mean, you had some idea of the movie going into it, and no. For Johnny, feel free to answer, but like coming into this movie, knowing that it's Andy Samberg, seeing the trailer, knowing that it's a rom-com and like about a time loop, and then knowing that The Lonely Island is a producer, like you haven't seen Popstar, but you know about The Lonely Island, like, you know, and you know about Andy Samberg and just like that kind of, that just absurdity that he is all about. So to see this movie, and then of course it has its funny moments, but to see everything else, the campfire scene between them when they finally like get their relation, like realize that, okay, we've been doing this day in, day out, but now we're finally gonna like, we're gonna move forward with this relationship and embrace it, like to see those more emotional moments, I mean, I was very surprised by that. That's not what I was expecting at all coming in. So to see that, like I said, like the rom-com drama, like, and to see Sandberg take the lead there, I mean, we've seen Kristen Milioti be dramatic before, but never really from Andy Samberg. And I mean, it's like Jake and I talked a few weeks ago about King of Staten Island and Pete Davidson, like saw another person with like a very like stereotypical, like what you would judge him as, and then coming into a project and showing more dramatic chops. So, I mean, I think it's the same sort of thing you see here with Samberg, and that's really exciting because it's someone that is so easily likable.
No, I 100% agree. I think I touched on that a little bit in my intro. It was just, I didn't expect that. And that, I think that's part of why it pushed it just over the hump from good to great for me. Because I think one scene in particular that really struck me and was when I kind of realized, okay, this is great. Like this is, he is great and this is great, was after they get arrested and they're sitting on the side of the road. And he finally, you know, they're really pissed off at each other. And it's really sad, but then he kind of reveals finally that they have been hooking up a lot and he lied to her. And so she feels betrayed. You kind of understand his perspective, where he was coming from, why he might not have said anything. And then just it's heartbreaking. Like, in his, you know, Sandberg's performance in the scene, his, you know, his facial expression, just everything about it, it really sold it for me. And I was like, okay, this guy, he's great. I mean, I know he's great as a comedic actor, but he definitely has more going on, and I would like to see more from him, you know, in other movies. But yeah, no, that was another element that, like I said, really put it over the top and elevated it just enough for me where I was like, okay, I'm totally like game on.
Yeah, I think that I want to ask, what were your thoughts on the twist here? I mean, we're kind of into spoilers already, but when we get that twist that Kristen Milioti hooked up with her sister's fiance the night before the wedding, like, that's what we later learn as the reason why she can't keep waking up here over and over, no matter how good it is with Niles. That, I mean, first of all, that's something that is pretty messy. Like, that's a heavy subject to touch on, that kind of like what that can do to a person and to her relationship with her sister. And like to see that, that's just like another example of like the depth that they were able to surprisingly go into and nail.
Yeah, I mean, one thing about this film that we've been talking about is that the emotional moments are executed well, but more importantly, they're earned. You know, they establish that Kristen Milioti's character, Sarah, is like, she's messed up quite a bit in her life. She's had a lot of mistakes, She's been having to been taken care of by her obviously very wealthy parents. And when that's revealed, when that happens, it feels earned, it feels natural, it feels organic, and her reaction feels equally natural and organic. And like, as much as we empathize with Andy Samberg's, just because of, you know, the joy that he's been throughout the film, we empathize with her as well, just because, just as he has been trapped for however many a time, she feels equally trapped, because she's living each and every day with a terrible mistake that she's had and that she's done. And to be able to grow out of that, to be able to understand that, to be able to move on from that, which I think is the most important thing about this film, is really it's getting down to moving on and moving forward. And they just do an excellent job throughout of making those things matter.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree more. That's an excellent point. And the pathos in this film was just like shocking. Like, I was like, where is this coming from? Like, I did not come in with this expectation. But like you said, they earn it, and that's through, you know, you set things up even without the audience realizing it. And then and they do that so much with so many different things. And that's what make the script is incredibly sharp.
Yeah.
I don't know what exactly it looks like on paper and what they may have changed, but you know, there's a lot of intricacies, because the comedic stuff, the dramatic stuff is all kind of sprinkled throughout. And then more in the second half, when you realize, okay, this is why this person's doing this, that's why they feel this way. Even one little tiny comedic example I can think of is in the very beginning, in the pool scene, he's laying on the pizza inflatable in the pool. And I can't remember what the character's name was, but I think he was part of the wedding party. He was the black guy. Mm-hmm. He swims up to him. And they kind of have like a little back and forth. It's funny. It's light. And there's a little like comment made that comes off as a little, there's like innuendo involved. And 30 minutes later, you find out that at least one of his experiences in the time loop, Andy Samberg had sex with this guy.
Yeah.
And that's what he's talking about. He's like insinuating that they may or may not have sex at some point. So just so many great little things that they were able to set up and pay off and just tie together. And I can't think of anything that wasn't well-rounded or tied up by the end of the movie.
I want to ask about the end, because
I was just about to ask that too.
Okay, go ahead. You pose your question then. Let's hear
okay.
it.
Okay, no, it's twofold. First, by the last 30 minutes or so, what did you think was going to, how it was going to end? And B, how did you want it to end?
I was very scared. I thought that when he after like they finally reconcile and he like joins her and they're going into the cave, I thought it was just gonna inception it. I thought they were gonna like go in and it was gonna explode and be a black screen and like the credits were gonna roll and it was gonna be like, what happened?
Yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah.
And I was like, I was worried that was gonna happen and that I was gonna be unsatisfied. But then the way that it actually did come out with them like floating in the pool. It's like for a second you're like, wait, so did it work or did it not work? And then the family comes home, and it obviously, I was just like, well, why did you still go back to that? I'd be getting the hell out of there if it worked. But I mean, I was satisfied with everything and the way that it came around.
Yeah,
Jake, what are your thoughts?
I mean, I thought it was excellent because we talk about the time loop films, and they mention it. It's like, oh, if we get karma, if we do one selfless act, the cycle will break. And that didn't work. So the very next thing is like, all right, it's quantum physics. And it's like, all right, yeah. Like the conventions of this film are so tight and so strong that it makes everything seem like, all right, yeah, that makes total sense.
Yeah.
And especially when she goes off on her quest to figure out what the hell is going on in the cave, and we see her learning, we see her on the conference call with the quantum physicist. It's like, oh, you should be teaching me. And the film is rooted in so much, it's funny, it's like grounded absurdity, you know, because like everything that's going on is zany, but we can believe it. And it pulled it off great. And I think ending at the house at his hideaway, and having his hideaway is not his hideaway anymore, was lovely. And then of course the end, when the perfect touch is when J.K. Simmons touches Andy Samberg's shoulder, and he
does. Ah, yes.
You know it, so you know good. It because he's in the
face,
suit.
You see his face and you're like, oh, that's lovely. Yes.
Yeah. No, yeah, and did you have anything else to say about the ending? Because I was just going to say what my thoughts were about.
Go ahead. Take it away.
No, I was similar to you, Zach. That's kind of what I was thinking, but I was on the opposite end in that I almost wanted it to end that way. When they were doing that kiss right before they were about to explode it, I was like, honestly, I'd be kind of fine if they just left it to who knows what happens. Because then if you're writing it and you're making the film, you do have to make a decision. Like, you know, what can we get away with? What's going to be most satisfying? But I was totally satisfied with how they ended it. And going back to what Jake said about the being selfless and that kind of that trope that they kind of played with is another example of something that they set up and did it really in a clever way where they paid it off later, was when she says that and whispers in her sister's ear and she starts crying and then she runs out. You're like, what the hell did she say to her? You know, Andy Samberg's character asks, what'd you say? Then later on, we realize she said that, she cheated like with her husband or fiance. Like that's what she did that was selfless. She came out and said, hey, I did this. And then, you know, even though she didn't have to necessarily. And then the ending, we know J.K. Simmons' character was another great, you know, finish with how he does get out of the loop. He gets to live his life. He gets to see his kids grow up, all that stuff, which I thought was great. The last thing I will say, I love the ending. Loved how they went back to the hideaway. I do think it was a little bit more of an Inception ending than you realize, maybe, Zach, because if you guys don't remember, the camera pans up and you see the dinosaurs walking.
Yeah. I know. I had the same. I was like, I watched it with Rebecca and I was like, is that, do you see that? Like, am I crazy? And I got up real close to the TV to check it out. But
So that is, I thought that was like the perfect end note to have those funny dinosaurs that even the first time they appear in the film, you're like, what the hell does that even mean? Yeah. What is
maybe
that?
They were just on like mushrooms or whatever in the pool. Yeah. And that's what it means.
So I loved how they wrapped it up. I thought they did it about as well as they could have. So I was satisfied for sure.
I'm with you. This is like you said, Johnny. I mean, I think this was the best new release of the week. I saw the same three that you did. So I would definitely suggest this one to anyone who's looking for something out there. And it's one, all the headlines said it. I made the same joke in my headline, but this is one that you can rewatch over and over again and you'll still be enjoying it just like they are in Palm Springs.
Yeah, no, it's definitely a top three. I mean, it's been a weird year as we always say, but top three film of the year for me so far, for sure. I really loved it. And
yeah,
can't wait to go back and watch it, because with these films, it's always fun to see how things change for your perspective.
I remember and I think that's a great note, because the rewatchability level of this is super high. One, because it's very quick, and two, because there's a lot of things that you will notice the second time. One thing that I noticed that stuck with me, just because I had just made fun of it, because I'd rewound the beginning of the film, because I was like, I'd watched Teen Wolf, and the fiance is Derek from Teen Wolf.
Yeah, yeah.
And then she's in How I Met Your Mother. So I was recognizing all these people. So I rewound it and I was like, I was like, all right, smash cut, then rack focus to Chris and Milioti, and then cut to Derek from Teen Wolf. And then later on, I realized why they rack focus to her, because
the infidelity,
and why they did that cut together. So noticing that like the first time, and I think that there's going to be a lot of cool moments when I come back and revisit it, because it's absolutely one that I would definitely check out again and again and again.
I don't know who this director is. I didn't see much. This may be his first feature. I'm not sure, but
I believe it is. Yeah, I think it was his first feature.
The filmmaking in this is legitimately, you know, as Jake just pointed out, real like strong. Like it's all very sound, you know, formally speaking. So I'm excited to see what this guy may end up doing next.
There was another little. I think it was an Easter egg, but when he has the one flash of one timeline where he finds the bomb in the cake, and he goes, "Don't worry, I'm a bomb guy." I'm pretty sure that was a reference to MacGruber, the SNL character, the MacGyver parody that he played on SNL, and that they made. Or no, was that even him? No, that was somebody else from SNL.
Oh, Will
Forte.
Yeah.
Man, but no, so maybe that wasn't an Easter egg.
They definitely, but it was interesting how, I mean, there's a random bomb in the wedding cake. Then, of course, at the end, she uses a bomb to blow up the cave. So, no, there are definitely a bunch of tidbits here and there that they sprinkle throughout. And it's just, that's, again, another thing that just elevates it to being great for me. So,
yeah, that's it. Palm Springs. Definitely check it out. Best of the week it's got the Inside the Film Room stamp of approval. So, we would highly suggest it. Thank you all for listening once again. Please be sure to follow us on social media, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, YouTube, at Inside Film Room, across the board. Please rate and review, subscribe wherever you get your podcasts, and join us next week for a review of The Iron Giant in honor of Jake Lawler's farewell episode.
Yeah, it's been these 2 and some change years have really flown by, and it's been amazing. Got some friendships for life, and I'm really excited to see where you boys take it next. I'll definitely be back on a guest, but you know, if everything goes right and I blow up, then
Vanity first Fair, interview.
Suck it.
Hey, you're gonna be cash rolling it at that point. So
yeah, I was like, yeah, they're gonna be like, hey, we want to do it on you. I'm like, nah, I got
it. We'll have to do. We'll have to have a disclaimer on the website and at the front of every interview saying, just disclaimer, Jake Lawler is an investor in Inside the Film Room. This article has not been swayed by that.
The birthplace of Jake Lawler. Oh,
exactly. Well, that's what's on the schedule for this coming week. Please come back and join us and have a great week. We'll talk to you next time.